قلبي على جمعة الخير هلا حني قلبي على جمعة الخير هلا يا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا يا هلا ويا هلا ويا
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the program. This is Let's Talk, coming to you live from our Sunning Hill studios in Johannesburg. And as always, well, I'd like to think, as always, we have a jam-packed program for you with some very, very interesting topics. And I do know once you hear what we're unpacking on the show today, you are going to become a part of the conversation. And if you do that on the open line, which is 011-086-7777, you can walk away with a sweet hamper from Broadway Sweets or a haircare hamper from Amka. We're going to be looking at anxiety with Dr. Colinda Linder. She's a psychologist. We're also going to be looking at the journey of someone who is now practicing CBT. His name is Junaid Khan, and he's going to talk about his journey and recovery through addiction and what it is that he can do to help you recover. And we'll be wrapping up by talking about epilepsy. So we hope you're going to keep us company on the open lines, and let's talk to our first guest this morning, the lovely Dr. Colinda Linder. Morning, welcome to the program.
Lovely to be here, thanks.
Absolutely lovely to have you here. Now, we're going to talk anxiety today, and as I think about anxiety, I kind of wonder, it is classified as a mental condition. And I didn't realize that till I spoke to you off air just now. I kind of wonder just how serious should anxiety be for one to seek assistance. And when one talks anxiety, you kind of think, it's something very frivolous, not serious enough to take to a doctor, to a psychologist. So having said that, Colinda, what exactly is anxiety?
Okay, that's a great intro, because I think often people think depression, bipolar, you know, these are the serious things, and anxiety, oh, get over it, you know. So loosely, you can think of anxiety as a family of disorders. Now, when is it normal anxiety and when is it a disorder? Same as depression, when you're just having a down day and when is it clinical? So anxiety, the family, is all about where you've got this unsettled feeling, you worry a lot, you just feel a little bit edgy. Now, I think a lot of people are thinking, well, that's me every day. So when that interferes, when you can't function, because you wake up in the morning and you're so crippled that you're just lying there wishing you weren't awake, or when you just worry to such an extent that you're immobilized, you can't function, you can't engage your kids, you can't work, and then it starts to move into the more clinical area, and there are a lot of different kinds of anxiety disorders. So we can unpack some of those.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I do want to come to, I want to look at anxiety versus irritability. Mm. If you're a very irritable or a very angry person, does that suggest that you're suffering from anxiety? Mm. But before we get there, just tell us a little bit about yourself. I know you're a practicing psychologist, but tell us where you're based and why are you so passionate about anxiety?
Okay, so I'll start with that first. So I've seen different numbers in the research, but one that sticks in my mind is that anxiety is the most common disorder you can have, and 1 in 4 is going to have anxiety at some point in their life. So that's a lot of people. Now, so I'm a clinical psychologist by training, qualified in 92, so it's been a while. And I specialize in cognitive behavior therapy. So there'll be more on that with your next guest, CBT. Right. And there are a group of us. We call the CBT group. And we practice from Legari, Premier Health Center. So there are lots of us there. So, you know, whatever you need, we'll cover it. Anyway, so why am I so passionate is because so many people have anxiety. And the good news is that you might need a combination of CBT and medication, and we have psychiatrists who work with us, who, you know, we work as a team, because you want the best approach for the person, for the client. So sometimes you do need a bit of both, and other times CBT alone, for example with panic, if it's uncomplicated, can actually sort that out within 8 sessions. So, you know, it's really nice to be able to get the protocol, this is the one that works, there's a bit of a guarantee there, and there's so few things in life with a guarantee, and people are out again within weeks functioning.
Yeah. I must be honest, Kulinda, I haven't come across anybody who has said to me, I've come across a lot of people who suffer from depression, from all sorts of phobias, bipolar, etc. But I've never come across anyone suffering from anxiety, or I've never come across anyone who's told me that they've been diagnosed having an anxiety disorder. Mm. So what exactly is it, and how similar or different is it to depression or perhaps phobias? Mm.
Okay, so if we can think of anxiety generally, the one that's the most common by far is called generalized anxiety disorder. And again, probably a lot of people are going to think, well, I've got this. The point is, do you have it all day? You know, do you have it to a crippling extent? So generalized is where you worry and you always assume the worst, and you know, you always jump to the worst conclusion. So say, for example, you
phone
home.
Most of us are like that anyway.
So say you phone home and nobody's answering. They must all be dead. Okay, so everybody's had that fleeting thought. But if you've got generalized anxiety, or GAD we call it, you have that all the time. So say you're driving along and there's some traffic. I'm going to be late, but you don't stop there. I'm going to be so late that I'm going to be fired when I get there. Or, you know, the kids are going to get to school so late that they'll expel them and everyone will think I'm a terrible parent. So it goes that extra the whole time.
So you really, your outlook on life and every situation in your life is totally negative.
And it's negative with worry. Mm-hmm. So with depression, it's just there's no hope. It's all bad. With generalized, it's more a catastrophizing, yes, and then it leads to that negative. So there's a massive overlap with generalized anxiety and depression, at least 70%. So you'll have the rumination, whereas with depression, you're more ruminating about the past and it should have and if only, where with generalized, it's more what if, what if, what if, what if. And again, we've all had that, but it's a matter of degree. You know, so if you wake up and it's crippling and that's all you can do, you can barely function, no matter what goes on, you're just extreme, you know, the whole time, looking for threat all the time. It's really a terrible way to live. You know, it can be quite debilitating.
Do people suffering from anxiety actually realize that this is the situation they're in, they need help, and would they go out and seek help?
You know, that is such a good point. And whoever's listening, if you recognize these symptoms, please phone SADAG, look at my website, Thoughts First. There's free CBT on there. Just get on the net. And I know Dr. Google isn't always reliable, but just investigate. So often anxiety, it's a chronic thing, generalized. So as a kid, you might be just a little bit more anxious, a bit more twitchy, a bit more scared for things at school or going out socially, or, you know, there's a family of anxieties. And you might just be that little bit more twitchy. And as you get older, you get used to that. So you might not know you've got this clinical anxiety. And as you quite rightly said, we all have worries and this is a difficult world we're in. And, you know, the whole world has come through a whole lot the last few years. So everybody's a little bit neurotic. But there is a difference. So people who don't have generalized, you know, where it's a sort of a bout of anxiety, you can be distracted, you can still enjoy things, you can put it aside. Whereas when it's clinical, it has built to the point where it takes over and just everything is seen through this filter of worry and pessimism and, you know, there's no hope, it's never going to get better, I've got no control. And you can imagine that by then the person's not really functional. So it's more those around them who are going to diagnose as opposed to the person.
Does it kind of tip over into depression? Does it get so bad that the patient then tips over and starts and becomes very clinically depressed?
Yes.
Or are we talking two totally different conditions, or is there an overlap?
Okay, I'm so glad you've said that, because you know the medical sign where it's got the snakes around the sword?
Yes.
If we look at it this way around, I first heard about this maybe 15 years ago at a congress, and it's been coming more into the research, just how much overlap. So if this is your anxiety snake and your depression one sitting here, when you treat the anxiety one with medication, CBT, the depression one often pops out. So these two are very interwoven. And you can imagine, it's not just with generalized. Say if you've had a phobia and you can't avoid it, say it's something you can't, or you've got, say, panic, or social phobia, where you don't feel comfortable performing, OCD, any of the anxieties. if you've had this chronic issue and you don't know what it is and it cripples you and it impairs your functioning, you will definitely feel powerless and slide into some sort of a depression eventually. I think that would make sense, you know, this chronic activation of the anxiety response. Eventually there's nowhere else to go.
Is it, you've indicated it is treatable, but do you live with this condition for the rest of your life on medication or with CBT?
Yes.
Are you ever completely cured? Can you reach that point where you are completely cured of the condition?
You know, unfortunately, with a lot of these, no. Because where they come from is there's a genetic base, there's always a genetic vulnerability, and then there are your events and things you learn and modeling. Say a parent was very anxious, that sort of thing. Remember, it's 1 in 4, so it's quite a lot. So you have a genetic base, so at best you can manage it. You know, it's almost like diabetes type 2. You've got your genetic base, and then depending on lifestyle and stress and so on, you can have it or not have it, or it will be better or worse. So with anxiety, some of them, like social phobia, the average age of onset is 6 years old.
Sure.
So that you will always have to an extent, but it, like anything, it can be managed. You know, it's like learning a set of skills. With generalized anxiety, it's quite chronic. So you tend to wax and wane through your life, and you may need just a very small maintenance medication and perhaps booster CBT sessions, depending on how well you took to the CBT. Something like panic, if it's a fairly late onset and you haven't really got it generalized with it, panic is one of my favorite things because it can actually resolve completely. So there's a much better chance with panic if it's just by itself and it hasn't become agoraphobia where you can't drive, can't go out. Something like OCD, that is very closely related, obsessive-compulsive disorder, and that is very close to generalized. So that is also chronic. It's probably the most biological of the anxieties, and that one usually requires medication, even just a low dose. And you've got to manage it. It's like with anything. You've just got to manage it, but it becomes automatic after a while.
Okay, we're talking to Dr. Colinda Linda. She is a psychologist based in Blairgowrie, Johannesburg, and we're talking about anxiety disorders, something I've come across for the first time. I've known about people who are very anxious or over anxious, but I never up until today realized that it's actually a clinical disorder. If you'd like to know more about it, please stay closely to your TV set, and you can also call us on the open lines. And still to come on the show, we're going to be talking to Junaid Khan about CBT therapy, and we'll be wrapping up by talking about epilepsy. So please stay with us on the show this morning. Our lines are open. Our guest this morning is Dr. Colinda Linda. She's a psychologist based in Johannesburg, and we are talking anxiety. If you have any questions or comments, we're happy to hear from you on the open line. Colinda, back to you, and let's talk about myths and misconceptions around anxiety.
Okay, I think you're asking all the most important things, because there's so much stigma, and you know, people tend to think, well, this is a mental disorder, you're crazy. So they either
but
think
it that... But it is classified as a mental disorder.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the one extreme is you're crazy, and the other extreme is I snap out of it.
Right.
So what we said at the beginning, and I think this was an important one, that, you know, we all worry. We all get a little bit anxious before we perform, or, you know, sometimes we do little feel-good rituals, and then everyone jokes and says, oh, that's OCD, you're being so OCD. And so anxiety is in our popular culture, but, you know, there's a very big difference between somebody who's just feeling worried about of stress that you're going through and somebody who's got a clinical condition.
Can I ask you this question? You know, you have those women who are constant worriers. They worry about absolutely anything and everything under the sun. Would they be clinically, would they be classified as being clinically anxious or suffering from anxiety?
You know, there's actually quite a good chance. Because often we just think, oh, you're just being neurotic, you've got nothing else to do. Mm-hmm. But this is a biological thing. It's like anything, diabetes, hypertension, you know, it is. And often my clients say to me, you know, I wish I could come out in green blotches when I was having an anxiety episode, so people would see it was real. Because we tend to write that off, oh, you're just being neurotic. So if you've got crippling worry to such an extent that you feel paralyzed, that you're like this ball of nerves all the time, and there's this hyper-arousal in the body, your heart's quicker, you're breathing quicker, you've got funny aches and pains, that could well be generalized anxiety disorder. And why suffer? You know, that can be treated. It definitely can be.
Can an anxiety disorder actually result in a panic attack?
Yes. Yes. Ooh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you get panic disorder, and panic shows up among all the other anxieties. So if you've got generalized anxiety and you worry, sooner or later, think of it as a pot getting too hot, it boils over. So that's what a panic attack is. Sometimes people don't have that. They've just got the genetics for panic, and there's a gradual build from many things, from maybe a bit of worry, a bit of stress, maybe they're working too hard, they're rushing around, and then that can cause the pot to boil and eventually boil over. So panic is also very interesting in that you can see it with, say, OCD. Like, say if I had a checking OCD and I was thinking, did I check my phone was off, for example, before I came on here? Then I'd be thinking, I wonder if it is. Let me think of how I can quickly go and check that. And if I couldn't, I might then start having a panic attack. Or say with social phobia, if I had it, I wouldn't be here. But say you're presenting, you know, and you're about to go on, and then you could have a panic attack if you're about to present to a room or whatever it is. So panic can show up with the others, and it always shows up with simple phobia. Say you're scared of dogs or spiders or that sort of thing. On exposure to that phobia, the stimulus, you'll have a panic attack. So panic pops up in different places, but it's the easiest to treat because we know it extremely well. It's been researched since the 60s, perhaps one of the first ones, and there are clear, clear protocols in CBT. Mm-hmm. So if you could pick out of all of them, pick panic.
Okay, brilliant. We have a call online. Assalamu alaikum to our first caller. Welcome to the show. Caller, are you there? Hello, caller? Assalamu alaikum, welcome.
Wa alaikum salam.
Welcome, and go ahead with your question. Thank you for calling in.
Okay, I have a disorder. I haven't been told exactly what it is, but I have seen a psychiatrist for it.
Go on.
Okay, and I'm currently on two medications. One is ORAP and one is Valium. And I just need to know how to effectively manage my condition because it's a bit difficult because I don't know exactly what it is. It's a little bit of OCD, it's a little bit of anxiety, it's a little bit of a stress disorder. I have no idea what I have. How do I manage this?
Can I just ask you one question before Dr. Linda responds to you? What did the doctor say to you?
The doctor said I have more of a bipolar disorder, schizophrenia type thing. But I know those are two totally different conditions.
Okay, let's hear what Dr. Kalinda has to say to you.
Okay,
this is a very interesting call because I think, you know, a lot of people are told, well, you've got this condition, take these meds, or this is what it is. So I think step one, I'm big on patient advocacy, which is why I'm part of SADAG. You need to know what it is that you're dealing with, because the caller is quite right that schizophrenia, bipolar, they are completely different, and OCD, anxiety, is completely different. So you can have a mood disorder, like bipolar depression, with anxiety. Yes, that is true. And the medications that she's on sound to me like bipolar. It's a bit more that, but it can be used for schizophrenia. There's nothing in there which is for OCD or for anxiety, besides the Valium, which is highly addictive long term. So, you know, and again, I'm just making a comment based on very little information. So I would return to the psychiatrist, or there's nothing ever wrong with having a second opinion for anything. And you need to know exactly what are you dealing with, because if you don't know what the problem is, how do you know how to treat it? The good news is that bipolar, if she mentioned bipolar, that bipolar is very, very sensitive to stress. So if there's stress going on, it is more likely you're going to have an episode. So you always want to be very careful with stress and with sleep. Sleep is incredibly important in bipolar, to have a good sleep routine. So my website, thoughtsfirst.com, has free CBT for both of those. So, you know, they can feel free to download. But those are the big two with bipolar. If there's OCD, you must be on the correct medication, and that would be what we call the SSRIs, your Prozac, your Arapax, that sort of thing. So I'm not sure I'm supposed to say those names, but that category is actually really necessary when you're doing OCD. And then, of course, CBT is the only therapy that's proven to work for that. And we have a specialist. I'm sure you'll have him on your show at some point. Mm-hmm. But, you know, so she can have a look at the SADAG website, sadag.org, and just start educating herself, you know, that do I have these symptoms? Do I resonate with bipolar or schizophrenia? Yeah, it's quite a strong diagnosis, that. Or OCD, it's pretty clear. You know if you have OCD. So I would always advise people, you know, get out there, empower yourself. And you need to own what's happening. You have this issue. It doesn't have you. And then you get yourself to the right place for treatment.
So you would say, most importantly, is for her to go back to her doctor, try and get a really clear indication as yes. to what exactly is yes. wrong with her, or possibly go for a second opinion.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, sister, I do hope that answers your question. Thank you indeed for calling in, and we will continue our discussion with Dr. Colinda Linda. She is a psychologist based in Johannesburg. Now, Linda, what's going to happen, Colinda? What happens if you are suffering from anxiety, never ever have it treated? What's your life going to look like?
You know, in one word, very small, because anxiety is all about threat. You know, if you think about it, it's you feel threatened by a lot of things, either situations or places or performance or just being out of your house. And so your world really constricts. It's very similar to depression. And often you develop agoraphobia. You can't go out. So it's just really you in your home. And that's such a shame, you know, because everybody's got something to offer in terms of relationships, the world out there. So that's unfortunately what happens, that it eventually just cripples you to that degree.
I'm thinking about children. We've got about 5 minutes left to wrap up time. And you indicated that at age six, children who suffer from this condition would present at age six. Yeah. What should mom and dad be looking out for? And if they suspect that their child is suffering from anxiety, is there anything they can do at that point in time? And will it hopefully cure them, that they don't take it into adulthood?
So social phobia, the average age of onset is six, but you can have kids with generalized anxiety from little. You know, even as soon as they have language, you can see that they're quite worried, they're wound up, they don't sleep easily, they don't settle, they startle easily. That can come even younger. Below the age of six, you can't really diagnose OCD, because all kids have little rituals. You know, when their parents go out, they must kiss them goodbye a certain way. But after six, you can start to see that. So let me run through the main ones. So if your child, say, has a speech at school and they're a little bit anxious, fair enough, exams, fair enough. But if you can see that it's starting to be a lot about avoidance, you know, I don't want to go to school, I've got a sore tummy. Kids often have physical symptoms, but unexplained. You know, I don't feel nice, I've got a sore tummy, school refusal, because that's often where these anxieties come out. Or they don't want to go and visit so-and-so, they don't want to play with a friend, they sit with you. So if you can see that this child isn't socializing to a degree, obviously they might be more introvert. But
and that's not necessarily because they're being bullied or they're being sexually abused by a relative, etc.
Yeah.
If they refuse to visit someone, we shouldn't necessarily jump to those conclusions.
That's right.
Or should we rule those out initially before we decide that this child might be suffering from anxiety?
I'd look at the whole lot. You know, anxiety and avoidance are like this. They always go together. So whenever you pick up that there's a pattern of avoidance, of going somewhere, doing something, school, you always want to look at what's causing this. And you're quite right that we tend to think it's something out there. But it could be something in here. You know, if the child is just really wound up and doesn't feel like they're coping, then you need to address that. So I would say you've got to look at both. What's the context, the environment, and what's happening in the child? There could be something physical. You know, maybe they're physically not well. But if you see a pattern that they're just avoiding and they're quite twitchy and they start to verbalize a lot of fears and things, if you see a pattern like that, especially if the fears spread, I'm not just scared of the dark, but I'm worried about this and worried about that, especially these scattered fears, then you really do need to take action as quick as you can.
Would you say that a child that's being bullied at school would be a very anxious child and could then suffer from anxiety, clinical anxiety?
Yes. You know, this is a chicken egg because the kids who are quite anxious are often seen as the targets. And a bully will always look for somebody they can attack.
They can pick them out a mile away, can't they?
Yes, and they get teased because often they're quite controlled, you know, and very well-behaved because they're trying to control everything because they're so anxious. And sometimes bullies will pick on that too. And exactly as you say, that it could be this way or it could be that way. So if you have a lot of negative coming in, you will definitely get anxious. And if you have any biological vulnerability for anxiety, so much more.
Sure.
But then it spreads and then you start to just be anxious across the board. And, you know, then it's a clinical disorder.
So if I identify my child as being extremely anxious, whatever the factors are, be it genetic and being bullying, etc., and I take the child to a psychologist or a doctor, is he going to be medicated at that tender age of six?
You know, it is possible, and often people are very anxious themselves about, you know, should I put this little innocent on something? And the thing is that if that child grows up and that they have this clinical anxiety and they're just fighting this all the time, you know, I almost feel what is the more humane thing to do? That just giving them something small, be it homeopathic, be it something else, you know, it could be lifestyle things, and in some cases, you might need to consider the meds. Whatever you can do to help that child get through the trials and tribulations of growing up, puberty, all of that, sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes you need to add the medication to the mix. But definitely, you know, CBT is very effective. I know you're
in children as well.
Yes, very much so.
Okay, we've got about a half a minute to wrap up time. My final question, if you start a child on meds and CBT perhaps at the age of six, would that child then be cured in a couple of years' time and not be an anxious adult, or would this plague them for the rest of their lives?
You know, the younger you start to learn coping skills and that your brain isn't under pressure the whole time, that the more likely it is that you're just going to have very, very mild anxiety as you grow up. Anything you treat when it's small and early hasn't really got time to take you over or to learn bad habits with. So, yes, there's a very good prognosis if you start
early. So, nip it in the bud.
Yes.
And that's where we leave it. Thank you indeed for being with us. It's been fascinating chatting to you.
It's been a
pleasure. Do hope we'll see you again sometime soon in the studios. That was Dr. Kalinda Linda, a psychologist, talking to us about anxiety. And next on the show is Sandra Pohl. She's going to talk to us about epilepsy. It's International Epilepsy Day on the 13th of February, so she's here to make us aware of this condition. Stay with us, we need to pay the rent. And welcome back. Next, we're going to be talking about another serious condition. Well, I say serious, but if you've got it in hand and if you are managing it, then you can live a very, very fruitful and productive life. We're talking epilepsy, and it is International Epilepsy Week and Epilepsy Day. So that's what we're uncovering in the next part of the show with Sandra Pohl. She is from Epilepsy South Africa. And once again, let me remind you that our lines are open. If you'd like to become a part of the conversation, we'd love you to. Please call in on the open lines. Sandra, good morning. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Good morning.
Now, I know you come from a social work background. You've been doing social work for the past 20 years or so, and you've just recently joined Epilepsy South Africa.
Yes, the Gauteng branch.
How's it been for you? Enjoying it?
Yes, I find it very interesting. It's completely different from what I've done before. another challenge, but I do enjoy it.
Wonderful. Now, it's International Epilepsy Day. It's also Epilepsy Week. And obviously, all around the world and in South Africa as well, there's a lot of awareness being created. Why do you believe the awareness is so important? Why should we be creating this awareness?
About 1 in 100 people suffer from epilepsy.
Sure.
And epilepsy can start for no reason at any time. And there are still a lot of myths and misconceptions around epilepsy and what it is. The International Epilepsy Week and Day for us start on the 13th of February on Monday. We're doing it in conjunction with 120 other countries over the world. And we've joined them since 2015. And it normally starts on the second Monday of February. It is important for us to celebrate the courage of people with epilepsy. And at the same time, to spread awareness as to what it is exactly.
So what exactly is epilepsy?
Epilepsy is not a mental condition. It's not a psychiatric disorder. It is a neurological condition. And what happens in the brain is that there's an unusual activity of electric messages. And that goes
Haywire.
Yeah. Okay. And then that would cause an epileptic seizure. This all happens in the hippocampus of the brain. And in about more than 60%, it is actually the cause is unknown. We do not know. We don't know why it started. We do not know what went wrong, but that is what happens. The other causes would be brain injuries, birth injuries, degeneration due to aging, because of drug and alcohol use.
Sure.
Yeah. So those are the reasons that can cause epilepsy.
So it's not a condition that has a genetic predisposition. If a baby is born and is injured whilst being birthed, that could cause epilepsy or other accidents. You're not born with the condition. That is what I'm trying to get at.
You're not born with epilepsy per se.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said, the cause is unknown. So if it should start all of a sudden without any cause, we do not know what that is. But if there was brain injury, or anything else that we think could cause it, then that's probably it. But in general, in most cases, where we only have epilepsy and no other psychiatric or mental disorders or brain injuries, we do not know what the cause is.
Now, you said that a baby could be injured at birth, you know, while the mom's birthing the baby. Something goes wrong and that baby then presents with epilepsy. How soon in the baby's life does it present, and will we know, will the medical professionals and mom know that my child is having a seizure, it's due to epilepsy?
I think what is important is that normally when there's a brain injury during birth, the cause is also a lack of oxygen.
Mm.
Which then leads to brain damage to some kind. So epilepsy, it would start at any time after that, but it's probable that epilepsy will then set on.
Mm-hmm. Now let's look at the myths and the misconceptions around epilepsy. I think we all need to be aware of that, because we probably would react in an inappropriate manner if somebody had a fit in our presence. What are the do's and the don'ts and the myths and the misconceptions around it?
Okay, let's start with the myths and the misconceptions. I think people are a little bit scared of it. People who are not used to it or do not know about it are scared when someone goes and has a fit, a seizure. therefore, you know, and there's also a lot of folklore around that. So there's myths around what their abilities are. So people who suffer only from epilepsy are completely capable of excelling at work, on sports, in anything what they do. They are completely able to do that. But yeah, you know what?
All right, let me ask you to hold that thought. We're going to pick up on it in a minute or two. We have a caller online. Assalamu alaikum to our caller. Welcome to the show.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to the guest as well, and assalamu alaikum and greetings to all the listeners. Sister Julie, yes, it's one a wonderful program today.
Thank you.
I'm epileptic now for 34 years.
Sure.
Now, we find that people have this misconception where they think people with epilepsy have evil spirits. And then another thing, whereby people with epilepsy, that I appreciate about this, when it comes to medication, people with epilepsy must make sure that they don't drink, because the medication and those doesn't go together. The reason I bring it up is because on a group on Facebook, somebody was asking other members if they had problems when they were drinking. And everyone actually told her that this is not something that goes together. Now, another thing, if I might share is, I had, in 2011, I had excessive seizures, but I was unaware of the fact that the tablet that the doctor gave me, it's named Alprazolam. I wasn't feeling well, and he gave it to me to relax, but I didn't eat enough. I only had a banana because I wasn't feeling well. So I had a banana before I had the tablet. And that was actually the cause. I can find out afterwards that I have to eat well before I eat the medication. And that led to me having excessive seizures.
Okay, can I ask you a question? Is it, are you fully in control? Are you able to control the condition, and are you leading a normal life as possible?
I shall say, alhamdulillah, shukr, if we take our certain steps, we do get seizures here and there, still unexpected. But if we do things that are harmful to us, for example, like going in the heat, that is also one of the triggers of seizures.
Mm-hmm.
So I try to avoid the extreme heat. When I know it is very hot, I stay in the house. Those are one of the things.
Okay, and finally, finally, what is your message to our viewers this morning? As an epilepsy sufferer, what is the one most important thing you'd like to leave our viewers with?
I shall say positive thinking is very important, because when we see positive, no matter what we go through, Allah Ta'ala will help us overcome these challenges. As long as we have our mind that we will overcome it, we are going to overcome them. I've had many injuries, and I've learned through that injuries, and I've shared through people. But can I share one last thing, Abajin?
Please.
I had a shoulder operation, but before the operation was done, my shoulder used to dislocate. my shoulder used to dislocate, and I used to pull my elbow towards my stomach. And if I hear that crack, I know that elbow is now in play, the shoulder is in play. And I always say, Allah gives you diet.
Okay, can we wrap up there? Thank you indeed. You've left us with lots to talk about. So we thank you indeed for your contribution to the show this morning. Assalamu alaikum to you. The call has raised a lot of issues there, and the one thing that also stood out for me was the medication.
Yes.
If you're not vigilant about your medication, you could be in trouble. Would you like to elaborate?
Yes.
And the correct medication, obviously.
Yeah. I would like to say, like with any other condition, you have to control epilepsy. And sometimes it takes a while before a neurologist would find the correct medication for the patient. It may make them feel not themselves. It may have other side effects. And those are the things that needs to be sorted out. A lot of our patients would just stop taking medication. And like this caller has said,
because of the side effects, obviously.
Yes. They stop taking it, they don't go back, and the seizures gets out of control again. Also, you cannot take alcohol or drink alcohol or any other drug with epilepsy medication.
What about if you have other existing conditions? For example, if you're a diabetic or you have a heart condition and you suffer from epilepsy, just how serious is that issue? But can I let you respond after the ad break? We do need to pay the rent.
Okay.
I'm talking to Sandra Pohl. She's from Epilepsy South Africa. That's what we're talking about in this part of the program. And we'd love to hear your thoughts or your comments, or perhaps you have a question for our guest. Do call in on the open lines, but first an ad break. We appreciate your company this morning, and we do hope you're going to become a part of the conversation. Still to come, we're going to be talking to Junaid Khan. He's a CBT practitioner and also a recovering addict. But right now we're talking epilepsy with Sandra Pohl. She's from Epilepsy South Africa. And of course, that's what we're unpacking now. And we are welcoming your calls on the open line. Now, Sandra, before the ad break, I asked you about other conditions, maybe a heart condition or diabetes or whatever have you. And then you find that you also get seizures from time to time, or possibly, you know, more often than you'd like. The interaction of all those meds, is it going to create a problem?
It would definitely create a problem if you don't seek the correct medical advice. We do advise that our patients go and see a neurologist familiar with epilepsy. And of course, the patient needs to inform the practitioner about all the other preconditions that they suffer from. Yes, and you can, with other conditions, still control epilepsy.
You spoke about the in-house facility that you have, I think, in Springs, Johannesburg. Now, and you're very anxious to talk about it. Why is that important?
Judy, you know, I started recently, like we discussed, and I have been amazed at, you know, what Epilepsy South Africa, Gauteng branch per se, are able to do for people with epilepsy. Being an NPO, being always in want of donations. So I think we have done a lot. I am amazed at that. And yes, we have residential care. We also have a protective workshop at that property in Springs, in Geduld Springs. So on a daily basis, we have about 200 clients.
Are they kind of treated as outpatients, or do they live on the premises?
Half of them, 100, more or less 100 of them, are residential care patients. So we house them, we feed them, and they are taken care of there medically.
Why is there a necessity for them to be housed at your facilities? Is that suggesting that their condition is so bad that they're right at the end of the spectrum, that they're not able to care for themselves, or their loved ones are unable to take care of them because of, I should imagine, this continuous cycle of seizures?
Not just that, Judy, it is also other conditions. I mentioned before that a lot of seizures or epilepsy can be caused by brain damage due to accidents, other reasons, or you know, during birth. So we are looking at a mental instability, psychiatric instabilities, disorders due to brain damage. And that would be the cause of the epileptic seizures. So therefore, they do need care. Their families are not able to do that all by themselves.
But I'd also like to think that there are those people who suffer from epilepsy, but not to such a degree that they are disabled or totally dependent on caregivers or loved ones.
Absolutely.
There are those people who are able to go out, work, be independent, marry, and even have children.
Yes, and there's nothing that prevents them from doing that. We even have a couple of marriages, married couples on our premises. So they can definitely lead a normal life up to what they can, their potential. Our aim is also to get them to become more independent. We do help with business ventures, and we try to help them to get back onto their feet, but mostly also to get the seizures controllable.
Somebody suffering from epilepsy and leads a almost normal life, goes on studies, finds a job, marries, has children, and is in the workplace as well. Obviously, he has to make his employers aware of the fact that he or she suffers from epilepsy, so that they do know that if he does, in the event that he or she gets a seizure in the workplace, they know how to deal with him. If they disclose their status, can they not be discriminated against?
Not according to our constitution. Our constitution recognizes epilepsy as a disability, and they need to be treated in the correct manner. So no, you cannot be discriminated against because of epilepsy.
If you suffer from epilepsy, can you get a driver's license, or does that rule you out?
No, not altogether. If you can prove that you've been without seizures for 2 years, you can apply to redo your driver's license if you had it previously.
All right. You also spoke about a training center or upskilling people who come to your center. Talk to us about that. And are you able to also assist them in finding employment?
So I need to separate that, because we have we have a workplace protective workshop on our premises, and a lot of people who cannot function in the open market come there, and they work there about a 6-hour day. On the other hand, we have got...
What sort of work do they do there?
We do basic work for, like, SAPI. We do work for SAPI. We do work for Mali at this point. We do also do work for Anyas.
What sort of work?
Who are a banting company. So for Mali's, we would assemble their plumbing appliances.
Okay.
It will be the...
Like a production line.
Yeah, it's a production line, mm-hmm. And it would not. It's just basically putting on the lids or putting in rubbers or things like that. For SAPI, we weigh papers and we pack that. Yeah.
So obviously, for the people coming into your protective workshop, their disability or their epilepsy is pretty serious.
Yes.
For them to have to come to you for work.
Yeah.
But the good news is, obviously, there are people who don't have it that severely, and they can be very functional.
Absolutely.
And as we've said, they can go on and lead a pretty normal life. We are going to be wrapping up in a minute or two. So what else of importance would you like to share with our viewers this morning as far as epilepsy is concerned?
I think what I need to share with our viewers is that there is help. A lot of people suffer unnecessarily. We service the whole of Gauteng from our branch. We actually are a national organization, but I'm from Gauteng, and we service the whole of Gauteng. We have community workers. We go out, we do assessments, we do help you into the right direction. So
both for the patient and the caregivers.
And the family,
mm-hmm.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, absolutely. So there is help.
Do you have support groups as well for people suffering from the condition?
We do run support groups in our local communities,
mm-hmm.
Especially when people come and they come and get their medication from the clinics, that we have our groups there. that's the easiest way to get them there. And yeah, from there, for support groups, and for the, from there on, we establish self-help groups.
Now, you indicated that you're an NPO and always in need of funds.
Always.
People watching us this morning would like to make a contribution. How do they go about doing that?
I would really appreciate if they could contact via email, if I can give the email address.
Or perhaps just go directly to your website.
Directly to our website as well. Mm-hmm. But I have to say that on the Gauteng branch, the telephone number there is wrong.
Okay.
Yes. But yeah, if you go to the website, you will be directed to our branch.
Wonderful,
eventually.
Wonderful. Thank you for being with us. You guys are doing amazing work. You're trying to turn lives around. You're trying to make people's lives meaningful and helping them along and making them realize that they are special. It doesn't matter what the condition is. They are special and they do mean something to somebody. So God bless and thank you for being with us, and much luck and success with Epilepsy South Africa.
Thank you very much. For
my pleasure entirely. That was Sandra Pohl from Epilepsy South Africa, creating awareness of the condition called epilepsy. There is hope, there is support. And if you'd like to make a contribution to this amazing organization, please visit their website, Epilepsy South Africa, and you can do your bit. Thank you for watching this part of the program. We need to pay the rent. And when we get back, we'll be joined by Junaid Khan to talk to us about CBT as a module, or rather as a way of turning your life around. It doesn't matter what the condition might be, but very especially for people suffering from drug addiction. And we're into the final segment of the show this morning. We are joined by Junaid Khan. He is a recovering drug addict and he is also a CBT practitioner. So do stay with us and the lines are open. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the program.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi. Thank you for having me on.
How does it feel when someone refers to you as a recovering drug addict? Do you kind of get a pang going through and thinking that's so negative? And I'm still being referred to as a recovering drug addict.
You know, I do a session called labeling, and it's the labels that we wear on our shoulders as we walk through the journey of recovery. And along the path, you tend to get accustomed to it. And that's the very intricate part of the recovery process, is whereby you accept these labels that's so, you know, put on you by your family or by, you know, members of the community. And at some point, you get accustomed to it, and you accept it. And right now, it's you look at yourself and where you're going in your life. Each one of us has our own journey to live through, and whatever encounters we come along the way, these are the important parts that we need to go through it and make ourselves more positive. That's basically what it is.
But I should imagine it would be with a sense of pride and achievement when you say, I am in recovery. I have been clean for X amount of years. And I know you've been clean for a long time now.
Mm-hmm.
Do you still believe that you should be wearing that label, recovering addict?
Well, I look at it in this way. If you actually want to dispose of that label, well, predominantly more because I'm in the field and it's my job. So it's something that I have to, you know, in terms of drug addiction, there is hierarchy. And with addicts, and as they go up the ladder, the experiences that they've encountered, the lifestyles that they've led, predominantly with me is because of experience, and also because of what I've been through. So a younger person would actually, I would say, it would form within hierarchy where they would actually look up to me and look at, okay, I cannot bamboozle this person, or I cannot, I need to, call a spade and be completely honest. So that would be my winning point, in terms of counseling and therapy. And that's the label that I have to carry forward. So over the last 10 to 15 years, I've carried that on. And that's basically where I'm at. In terms of normal human beings that, that have encountered addiction and have in some way on the recovery process, they, for example, don't need to wear these labels. Their life, their integration into society is a lot better. Most of them forget, 5 or 10 years later, they forget that they ever had an addiction problem. So a lot of them just carry on normally with life in that manner.
Does society forget and forgive you?
Actually not. You know, I just want to refer to something that happened last night. One of my clients, who's going to be 2 years clean in April, and he had called me at about 8 p.m. last night and saying that, you know, he was in a situation and he's had his slate clean for the almost 2 years, and his family had nothing to pick on him about. And he was doing some business deal within the family, and they didn't like what he wanted, so they picked on the past.
Mm.
And he felt, you know, looked down upon a judge because of that, and which is wrong. So in some ways, the family is also wrong, because if they have nothing to pick on you with, you know, so, and they pick on your past. So in both ways, we got to look at dealing with these labels, so to say, and as you're going forward in your life. So for this client of mine, he felt down and depressed, and he sort of felt that whatever he's achieved in this time hasn't been, you know, good enough for his family, so to say, that kind of thing. Well, that's what life is. We've got to live with it.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing? As an addict, you felt you were being judged all the time. By the way, how long have you been clean?
Well, about 15 years.
Alhamdulillah, and may you remain clean for the rest of your life. And may you continue touching other people's lives in a positive way. I also know that you work with the Al Khalil Support Group in Mayfair, Johannesburg, and you run your own recovery practice from home, a private practice. We'll talk a little more about that in a while or two. Coming back to your client that called you last night, was that a bad thing to happen to him? Was that something that could have tipped him over?
Absolutely. You know, if you could look at it, that all I've achieved in the last 2 years, approximately, it could have been all in vain, and nobody appreciates what I'm going through, and blah, blah, blah. And
so what's just the relax. Point?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, and well, he's booked a session with me today, so he's coming to see me. So he actually needs to revive that and deal with the emotions that he's going through. Although he's 2 years, almost 2 years clean, but these are the things that do happen. So he's doing the right thing. He picked up the phone, he called me, he discussed what has happened. He needed my surety to say that, you know, under those circumstances that, you know, his family's labeling him again, you know, is he right or is he wrong in whatever has happened?
But by the same token, if you've been guilty of anything in your life, let's assume you were a thief or you embezzled books, you know, at your company, whatever have you. I guess people will always remember that. Maybe not judge you for the rest of your life, but they'd always kind of watch you with the beady eye.
Well, I think that's normal in normal day-to-day living. People remember the bad things that you do, but don't remember the good things that you do. Mm. They were, if you do 9 good things and 1 bad thing, they'll remember the bad thing. That's life. That's humanity. That's the way world we're living in. And we just got to accept that. And as drug addicts or recovering drug addicts, you got to deal with more than what it is, because you put yourself in harm's way and you gave the people around you the finger to point on. So you got to deal with it.
You made the wrong choices.
Yes.
When and why and how did the wrong choices in your life start?
Well, I think there was a lot of wrong choices. You know, I have a group of friends that are still my friends. You know, we've been friends since primary school.
Are they clean?
They all were clean. Well, they all, you know, and none of them did drugs. And
okay.
I was the only one that ended up from them. And there was a point in my life where I disassociated myself with them. Me predominantly, not them, because I was doing the wrong and I couldn't fit in within their company. And now we're still, you know, friends. So I could say in my point, it wasn't the friends that actually led me astray. I think it was predominantly me as an individual that, you know, that was searching for things in life and that wanted a kick out of things. And experimentation was very, you know, I would do anything. I was daring. I would take on the challenge, take on the risks and all of that. So I think that was a very committing factor. I think money was also a committing factor at a very young age, having a lot of money. And losing it all and, you know, going through all of that, put me in harm's way in terms of, you know, attracting the wrong company. And it's the lifestyle that you're attracted to. And that's it. You know, it's not the high per se. It's more the mission, you know, and what you're doing and the fun that you're having, the risk that you're taking. These are all of the things, but it eventually catastrophizes and falls on you and you don't see that happening. And, you know, my rude awakening was death. I was at death's door, and that's it. There was no other place. Drug addiction leads to 3 avenues, and that's it. It's prison for life and an institution for life, or the grave. These are ultimately the three destinations that you would encounter. And along that path, as in terms of drug addiction, you're blinded to that, you're in denial of it, you don't really see it. And only when you're hitting rock bottom does that awakening come through.
Have you relapsed in your recovery ever? And is it normal for people to relapse, pick up the pieces and move on again?
Well,
can
initially,
it be done?
Yes. Okay. I was on a drug called crack cocaine, which is a binge-using drug.
Meaning?
Where you binge, you can't use it every day.
Why not?
Because your body cannot handle it.
Uh-huh.
Okay, your mind cannot handle it. You crash. So you need a recovery time. And then it's normal, especially in Muslim communities. You know, they would tend to start reading their namaz, go to mosque, become more pious, become more spiritual.
There's nothing wrong with that. Alhamdulillah, we hope that that will make them see the light.
Yes, it does.
Dua, obviously.
Absolutely.
You can't underestimate the power of dua.
The intention that it goes with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you're going to do that, so it's, and there's a lot of misconceptions around it. It's like, if you want a job or you're in need of money, you can sit on a musalla and ask me, make a dua. But you have to go out and get it. That's basically what it is. So with the same token, in recovery, you got to make those changes in your life. You're not going to sit there and expect everything to happen. Yes, the behavioral change in the actions of your salah helps you. No doubt about it. Okay, that's intricate. And I still say spirituality is intricate in the recovery process. And it's one of the key factors. But again, it's the intention that you're using it for. So these are the things that do encounter, and a lot of people fall by the wayside because they don't follow through with these things. It's the lifestyle changes that need to take place that are of utmost importance, along the path of the recovery process. So those are the things that do need to happen. And, when we need to put a hands-on approach to it, including the family as well, that's how recovery can happen.
Okay, we spoke about crack cocaine, suggesting that it's widely used in the Muslim community.
Yes, it is. It was or is very expensive. And there's a derivative that came off from it, and it's being used right now. The Cape Town drug methamphetamine, crystal meth, which is now coming to Johannesburg, on a large scale. And it's becoming the cheaper crack cocaine. So those that were crack cocaine addicts 10, 20 years ago, are now into crystal meth.
Okay. We need to pay the rent when you get back. Sure. I also want to talk to you about, obviously, we're going to talk CBT. And I also want to ask you about Niaupe and Bluetooth, which is the big news at the moment. Is it prolific in our areas or not? But let's first pay the rent. I'm talking to Junaid Khan. He is a recovering drug addict. We're talking about his journey in and out of addiction and how the CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, has helped him stay clean. Stay with us. Lines are open. And welcome back to the final section of the show this morning. We're talking to Junaid Khan. He is a recovering drug addict, and he is also a CBT practitioner, and he believes that cognitive behavioral therapy is what helped him stay clean. He studied CBT in the UK a while ago, and it was a four-year course, and he is practicing CBT with recovering addicts, and his success rate, alhamdulillah, is quite high. Back to you, and we'll get hopefully to CBT in a minute or two. Sure. But you want to touch on the drug of choice amongst Muslim youth in and around South Africa. Why is it so important for us to talk about that?
Well, over the last 15 years, I've had experience amongst Muslim communities in Cape Town, Durban, and Johannesburg, the three major cities in the country. And in that, predominantly in the Muslim communities as such, and how it's inflicted as a pandemic in the community.
A pandemic.
I'm going to take it to that level, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's start off, we can look at, the drugs of choices over the socioeconomic environment or areas that we're coming from. And the different choices of the different drugs would supersede in those particular areas. We're currently in Johannesburg, so Johannesburg would be, cat would be the drug of choice amongst the Muslim community.
How do they ingest it?
It's snorted through the nose, okay? And right now, cat is methketanone, which is probably the active ingredient. But over the last five years, I would say, the influx of ephedrine that's come into the country, which they're cutting down the cat. And if a person that is using cat and if they're drug tested would show positive for methamphetamine, which is actually crystal meth.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually cut down more, and the active ingredient of mercaptan is no longer very little in use, and it's taken over by crystal meth, which is methamphetamine.
How damaging is it to the system? And how addictive is it?
Well, it's addictive in terms of, predominantly most addictions is more psychological than physical. Heroin, for example, is the physical addiction where the body withdraws and it goes through the cold turkey stages. And these are the things that make the drug addict go back or look for more drugs. But in terms of the upper drugs, which would be crystal meth, cocaine, crack cocaine, all of these drugs, cat, that are there, they are known as upper drugs. And what happens is when you come down or you crash and you're trying to recover, the depression is very high because what goes up must come down. So as much as you're feeling intoxicated at some point, you're going to go through the symptoms of depression. And under those circumstances makes when the person or the addict is actually in the depressive state, makes them go out to look for more drugs to take away the depression, to bring that euphoric feeling back.
So you're caught up in this vicious cycle.
In the vicious cycle.
What is it that parents need to be looking out for? And sadly, it seems that kids are getting hooked at a younger age.
Sure.
So what are the signs and symptoms parents need to look out for? And I should imagine the sooner you kind of nip it in the bud, the sooner you catch your loved one out in drug-inducing habits, the sooner you can get them onto the road of recovery.
Sure.
So what is it that parents should look out
for?
Well,
it's indifferent. Well, we can say parents and we can say spouses too. Okay, that's where it's gone now. That first and foremost, it's the behavioral. You can pick it up in the behavior. They're all designer drugs out there. So they're not supposed to be, in actual fact, detectable. Okay, and that's why more Muslims are using it. Because, for example, if you use alcohol, you can smell the alcohol on the breath. On the body odor, but with terms of these designer drugs that are out there, they're very easily disguised. You can't really see it. So, but you can make it out in the behavioral patterns. So first and foremost, I think the eating and sleeping are the two things that everybody, every human being has to do. So those are the two pointers that you can actually see it. So excessive sleeping or not sleeping at all. So for example, if a person would be using cat or would be using cocaine, so their sleeping patterns, it's a sleep deprivation. So what happens, they wouldn't be able to sleep for probably 24 hours or 48 hours if they have to take a sedative, or they will eventually crash after 48 hours of being awake. In that time, you could actually see within the household that somebody is not sleeping. You can see that they just erratic behavior, walking up and down, not conclusive in whatever they're trying to achieve. That's one of the reasons, that's one of the telltale signs. The other one is the eating, okay? You would see them not eating or just tit-pitting on something. And then after 2 or 3 days, they go on a binge, they start eating everything out the fridge. You know, they would eat everything inside. So those are the behaviors that you can see. You know, it's quite evident.
Okay, we've got about 7 minutes to go, and I do want to touch on CBT, but very quickly, what does a crack cost? You know, so obviously you're going to either, the child goes through money very quickly or starts stealing. How expensive is this habit?
Well, 200, 250 rand a gram for cat in Johannesburg, 300 rand a gram for cocaine in Johannesburg. In Durban,
and how long does that last?
It depends on the user. It could last between 1 hour and 5 hours for a gram. It depends on the extent of their use and how much they become an addict and how much they're consuming in that time. And that's basically what it is. Heroin, which is Nayope or Wunga, is also very predominant and depends. It's on the more lower socioeconomic areas that it would be prevalent in. Well, that's where it is. And crystal meth is still in Cape Town, which heroin is also very big in Cape Town. Heroin is also very big in Durban, and depends on the communities here in Joburg. It's called Nayope, and it's also, it's a derivative of it. There's Wunga, there's Thai White, and there's Nayope.
And that is all smoked?
They all smoked. Well, they smoked mostly, okay? Mm-hmm. And Chasing the Dragon is injecting and shooting it up. Those are the two parts. Chasing the Dragon is on a foil, that they smoke it on a foil, or they smoke it in a cigarette, or in a rolled up cigarette. Those are the things that they would use. And those are the drugs of choices that, in terms of Muslim communities within South Africa.
Which is cat.
And cat as well. Cat mm-hmm. isn't in Johannesburg.
All right. CBT, and I know that you studied in the UK for 4 years. How did that turn your life around, and how are you touching other lives with the CBT?
Well, in terms of the recovery process or drug rehabilitation, so to say, you know, for decades now, for past 60 years, almost 80 years, 70 years, I think in the 1940s, that the 12-step program come out in terms of a rehabilitation process of what needs to go through. I studied it because it wasn't available in South Africa at that time. And I looked at it that it was hands-on, and it was, you could make the change within yourself. It was dependable on you. And it was a fairly new modality that has been exposed to the world. And it was very much in seeding stages. And now it's actually found some foundation and some, you know, in terms of success in going forward in terms of the rehabilitation process. And it's being very recognized. But alhamdulillah, I picked it on well before the time, so which gave me the experience to actually carry on, you know, going forward with it in terms of the rehabilitation.
Were you clean already by the time you decided to do the course?
Yes.
You were.
Yeah.
And you've now come back to South Africa. You've been here for a while. You're helping run a support group in Mayfair, the Al Khalil support group, together with Aisha Hurzuk. And you're also doing private rehab. Tell us about that. What sort of method do you use in rehabilitating young people or the
addicts? Over the years, and it's become a norm, you know, there's a whole hype around rehabilitation and the notions behind it. Rehab is, you know, everybody has a story about it. Specifically, a parent would send a child to rehab and come back out and the child relapses, they would blame the rehab, you know. And on the other hand, the rehab would blame the addict or the recovering addict, but you didn't do this and you didn't do that. So it's a lot of stone throwing in both directions. But what happens is, mostly at rehab, when a patient or a client goes into rehab, at that point in time, there's 20, 30, depends how many people are at rehab at that time. You don't get the individual attention. It's it's one size fits all, so to say. You don't really get as much as one-on-one individual attention and really look at the life structure of that addict at that time and how to restructure their life so that they could live their lives drug-free.
So you believe the one-on-one approach is what would work?
Yes, that's what's helping at mm-hmm. the moment. And the key factor of that is the aftercare sessions, and that is of utmost importance.
Also one-on-one?
Well, it's at the group, you know, with the aftercare groups. I have another one in Houghton as well. So in with these groups, they're key to actually surviving, you know, or missing a relapse. Because at that point, you know, it's very common. It's very easy to relapse. It's a learned behavior. And it's something, all of us, something goes wrong in our lives almost every day. And as a drug addict or as a recovering drug addict, we only know one thing, is that to go back to our drug of choice as a comfort zone, mm-hmm. as a coping mechanism to actually help us go through the day. And normal human beings, they don't know that, you know, they would do something else. But we as recovering drug addicts would go back to those behaviors that we learned.
Because it makes you feel good, it makes you feel safe.
It's an escapism.
How many sessions would it depend on for how many years you've been an addict? Or does that not matter? Is it up to the individual? That being said, how many sessions would they have to come to you for to hopefully become clean, and what's your success rate like?
Okay, between 12 to 15 sessions. That's all in all, it depends. The easier, the younger, the better. Although they have newer, like a 23-year-old, for example, it would be easier, because if he or she started using from the age of 15, 16, you just got seven years, and that, you know, these are the behaviors, that the mindsets has changed, the belief systems have changed. So we got to bring that back to normality and actually bring it to reality first, to actually let them look at what is actually going on. And then, for example, if somebody is in their 40s or late 30s, it's a little bit more difficult because these are the lifestyle that they have carried on in, you know, a decade or two into their life. And that takes a little bit longer to change. Or it also makes an important fact that they've come to rock bottom at that stage. And they've come to their own realization that all of these mishaps that I've been through in my life, I need to change right now. So it works with both ways. So it, you know, it's tailor-made. It depends on the individual at that time and where they are in the recovery or the addiction process.
And you use the cognitive behavior therapy
modality
with your patients. Sure. And your success rate?
So my success rate, I would say it would be close on to 90% because it's one-on-one.
Alhamdulillah. Okay?
And it's follow through with them. It's very little. I do a little at a time, but I do it properly. And in terms of that, I'm hands-on with them for the next year, and we look at it.
So we end this program on a note of hope.
Sure.
As other people tell us that once an addict, always an addict, you are dispelling that saying that inshallah, through CBT and other modalities, there is hope and you can obviously recover totally and gain your life back.
Absolutely.
How do we get hold of you? Have you given your telephone numbers?
No, it's 072-6786.
Okay, brilliant. If people are not able to reach you, they'll get in touch with the studio and we'll pass that on. Thank you indeed for sharing that with us. Khuda hafiz, and please continue touching lives in a positive way, inshallah.
Yeah.
And that then brings us to the end of the show this morning. We do hope that you've enjoyed what we've lined up for you. Let's wrap up with our thought of the day, which is, if you have good thoughts, they will shine out of your face like the sun, and you will always look lovely. And on that note, with a big thank you to our production team, it's time for us to wrap up. Thank you for being with us till Wednesday morning at the same time. It is Khuda Hafiz from me, Julie Alli.
جمعة الخير هلا حني قلبي على جمعة الخير هلا يا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا يا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا يا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا ويا هلا